Buildings are a part of our everyday life and are the fundamental building blocks for a living, breathing society. But if these structures are so important to such a society, why then are they often built so inadequately? They serve their purpose well, but yet do not remain sustainable. To better understand this, we will look at the entire life cycle of a common building and how its current state of being isn't its only state of being. Many of these sustainable buildings must be examined to see how we can and should improve the materials, construction, maintenance and use, and end life of many of our buildings. Before we can understand a building's life cycle, however, we must also analyze the life cycle set forth by the American Institute of Architects, or AIA. These key aspects, defined by the American Institute of Architects, are the stages of every building's life cycle. Cradle to Grave focuses on a full LCA, or life cycle assessment, from the very beginning to very end of a building, including its destruction and relocation of resources to other sites or landfill. Cradle to Gate takes a much smaller approach, examining the elements of a project before they reach the site. Cradle to Cradle is similar to Cradle to Grave, except this process sees the reuse and recycle of materials from a former project to be used in future projects. Gate to Gate is the most specific, focusing solely on one piece of the project while it is in production. In case there's any confusion, we want this one, the Cradle to Cradle, where we manage to perpetuate the process into a cycle that can be repeated. As such, we will need to take into account the four stages of the construction process: material manufacturing, construction, use and maintenance, and end of life. Each one is very important, but perhaps the one that is most important is the use and maintenance portion. This is a measurement of the building's use on a daily basis, and is therefore the most important aspect in a building's life. In short, the building should fulfill the purpose for which it was designed in an energy-efficient manner. As a method of examination for a building's use and maintenance, we will be using two methods of measurement, the Energy Star Rating and the Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design Rating, or LEED. Energy Star is a program from the EPA that determines the energy efficiency of buildings and materials. Energy Star gives a building a rating from 0 to 100. LEED is a program from the U.S. Green Building Council that pushes buildings to be more sustainable to benefit human health and well-being. The LEED program point system is determined by building type and focuses on a much wider range of aspects within the building. Let's take a look around Minneapolis to see how we can use this information to make buildings more sustainable. 1200 South Washington Avenue. This is your typical building downtown. During its design and construction in 1941, its life cycle was not taken into account. 1200 is a classic case of gate-to-gate life cycle, where only the here-and-now functions were thought out. Although it serves its purpose, this is exactly what we should not be doing with our buildings. It has not been renovated to improve its performance, so it is still performing extremely poor in terms of the environmental effects. Energy Star awarded 1200 in South Washington with a rate of 2. However, the LEED program is unable to even score the building. A suitable contrast to the extremely poor performance of 1200 South Washington is Butler Square. Built in 1906, this building was likely built with the same purpose in mind, the need for a warehouse in the here and now. Butler Square, however, is an excellent precedent for buildings to follow because of the many sustainable changes made to its structure throughout time. While 1200 Washington's design left it with a meager score of 2 out of 100 for the Energy Star, Butler Square's extensive remodeling and modernization efforts have allowed the building to garner a score of 94. On top of this, Butler Square was also LEED certified in 2009. Many of the building's structural elements, including the original timber reinforcements, still stand to this day, but a number of new innovations, including the use of high-performance programs, installation of sustainable materials, and documentation of emissions and input have allowed Butler's rather antiquated design to remain relevant in this modern age. Other, much more recent projects can be found on this campus, and in fact, you're sitting in one right now. The University of Minnesota's Brunings Hall, or STSS as it was formerly known, is perhaps the most up-to-date example of sustainable building design. Following its completion in 2010, the building quickly achieved LEED Gold standard. Despite lacking an ENERGY STAR rating currently, the building is a major feat of sustainable design. Beginning literally from the most basic building blocks, the new building was a brownfield development that utilized part of the existing foundation. Use of high albedo surfaces and green spaces reduced the heat island effect caused by the building, and the use of natural vegetation allows for an ecological response to rainwater runoff. During construction, 94% of construction waste was diverted from disposal to landfill, and locally recycled and manufactured materials took the highest priority. The exterior glass of the building was custom fitted to be functional and beautiful, with glass minimizing glare and reducing solar heat gain by 50%, while allowing maximum amount of light to flow into interior spaces. Buildings represent the landscape of human society. They reflect our ingenuity and dominance over the places we inhabit. But this power comes at a great cost, one that we have largely ignored up until now. It is our job to be conscious of how our actions impact the world around us. Therefore, we want you to be mindful of the things that you design and you create. The world is a much smaller place than you think, but with any luck, that means it should be that much easier to create a world where humanity can live in harmony with the rest of the planet.